Welcome to Information Service Engineering. This is lecture number 6, Knowledge Graphs. In this last section of the first Knowledge Graph lecture, we will talk about how to identify and access things on the semantic web and the web of data. And we do this with the help of URIs. Before we start, let's do a little experiment. Okay, what is this? Of course, most likely you will say this is an apple. If this is an apple, then what is this? And what's the difference? So if this is a real apple, then this, of course, is not an apple. It's a picture of an apple. However, we took it as an apple. And this is really a nice feature of our brain. So we can take a referent, a substitute, and treat it like the real thing. And this is also something what language does for us. So you already know that kind of semiotic triangle. We have some kind of symbol from language, apple, which states or stands for a kind of apple that you have somehow the concept of in your brain. But it stands for a real object. And the concept refers to the real object. And all of that construct, symbol and concept, this can be used as a substitute for exactly the real thing. And this is also the same principle we will follow also in the semantic web. What we have there, we are also talking about real things. But of course, these real things we can't put on the web. On the web, there are only kind of electronic documents. There are not the real things. However, we want to make assumptions about the real things and we want to put identifiers up there for the real things. And we can do this in the same way like we do this here for language, or we do this in our brain with pictures of things. So we substitute the stuff simply. Okay. The way how we identify whatever is up there in the web are the so-called uniform resource identifiers. A uniform resource identifier, URI, defines a simple and extensible schema, you know this already, for worldwide unique identification of abstract or physical resources. And thereby, a resource can be every object with a clear identity according to the context of the application. So it can, of course, be a web page, as well as it can be a real-life book, it can be a location, a place, it can be a specific person, it can be relations among objects, it can be something abstract, whatever. You can denote it with a simple reference, and this is then the URI. URI concepts are already established in various domains, so in the web anyway, with these addresses, so URL, Uniform Resource Locator, is a web address. However, also for books, URIs are implemented, so you might have heard of ISBN and ISSN, and also for other kind of digital objects, so there is the digital object identifier, which is a URI, and many more. So for a general difference, URL identifies what exists on the web, so any kind of web document, and the URI identifies on the web what exists. So this is a nice word play, but of course you have to distinguish between, of course, the reference of the thing in the web and the real thing. However, you might use the reference on the web for a real thing to make assumptions, to make statements about that. So this is then the URI, also the basic layer for the web of data here. Let's try another example. So we have a kind of resource. The Earth, our beautiful blue planet. However, the Earth, of course, is not on the web. If we want to talk about the Earth on the web, we need some kind of reference, so an identifier. That reference is something which stands for the Earth. So we might have a URI which identifies the Earth. So this might be the Wikipedia page of the Earth. However, if we look at the Wikipedia page, this is only some kind of metadata and data about the Earth. So this is a representation of the Earth. So it stands for the Earth on the web as a web page. It's not the Earth, it's only a representation of that. And the nice thing is, so Of course, this HTML representation, if we look at it in our browser, we come to the web page of Wikipedia, and this then is the presentation. So the representation, HTML page, defines the presentation that we see in our browser. And from a linguistic point of view, the Earth is described, or what the linguists say, it's designated by a web page, whereby the thing that is described or designated is the so-called designatum, and the thing that describes the object is the so-called designator. Keep this in mind for, you know, making things clear what we are talking about. Sometimes we are not talking about the real object, we are only talking about its representation, or moreover about its presentation. And we can identify the real object, however, with a URI that provides a representation on another medium, like on the web, for example. Okay, so there are already URIs out there for any kind of things, but you might now want to define something which exists only in your own domain. So for example, yourself, are you already on the web? Do you have a URI that identifies you on the web? If not, let's create one. But as soon as you create your own URI, of course, you should try to avoid overlaps, which means use always your own website or your own namespace that you have there for your URIs. And of course, you should enable also the documentation, which explains what you have there on the same place, which means you might have on the one hand side data about the subject you put on the web, as well as a human readable web page. And the point is, both of them, of course, should have them different URLs, different web addresses, because the data should be available under another address than, let's say, the HTML content that the human is then reading about that. However, what you can do, you can identify both via the same URI, which then is translated to different URLs with a web concept which is called HTTP content negotiation. HTTP content negotiation is something which is carried out in the web server, and the web server then simply relays to a specific version of that information, which is provided in a specific representation form. Traditionally, so in the past, this kind of content negotiation is, for example, used in the browser if you are accessing international websites, and if the browser tells the website that it understands English or it understands German, then content negotiation helps you to deliver the correct language version then to your own browser back from the web server. So this is done automatically via content negotiation, since the browser asks for, let's say, a German or English version of a website. The same thing works out here in the web of data, and there, of course, we distinguish not between different language versions, we distinguish between a human readable form of HTML and a machine readable form, any kind of RDF serialization format. Okay, again, what we have to think of, we have to use separate URIs for the resource, which is the designatum, and its documentation, which is the designator. And we do this via HTTP content negotiation, and there are other possibilities. So for example, you can use URI references, for example, via fragment identifier. However, we are looking now into the HTTP content negotiation mechanism. So let's follow the following example. I want to have information about the Earth from DBpedia, that general knowledge base on the web. I do this via HTTP, and I send an HTTP request to the website. And if I do this usually in my browser, so what the browser configures there is it sends an HTTP GET request, and of course the browser wants to have back a human readable form. So the accept header type, the MIME type that this header accepts, will be text HTML. However, the URI that we are accessing is the resource Earth. If this comes to the web server has to decide according to the MIME type in the accept header what type of resource is delivered back. And therefore, since this is text HTML, the web server relays this information via the HTTP code 303, which means see other, and then gives back the URI, which contains the information we are looking for, which then has to be accessed via the browser again with the accept header text HTML and the HTML document, which has another URI. You see that here. So if we look at it here, you see here, we have looked here for dbpedia.org/resource, which was the resource without telling what kind of information we want to have. The information we were looking for was here in text HTML in the accept header. And then the web server translated it here to page, which contains an HTML page of exactly that information we want to have. So this is human readable. For the case that we want to have this in machine readable form, the only thing we have to change there in the GET request is the accept header, because we can tell it there that we don't want to have text HTML. We can say, for example, we want to have application RDF XML, which is one of the many available serializations of RDF. So this always depends on the web server. So you have to find out which formats the web server supplies. So probably you can also access it in Turtle or in JSON. So there are other RDF serializations possible. We have here the example with RDF XML. We are looking for exactly the same URI as in the example before, but here now, since we have asked for another accept header, this original URI will be translated and relayed back to another URL. And this here is then dbpedia.org/data/earth, since here RDF XML was asked for. And what is returned in the end then will be an RDF XML document, not an HTML document. So this is a huge difference. We can have a look at an example that we do in the terminal window. And you see the example here then on the next page in the presentation. So what we are trying to do is we want to open a terminal window, and then with a interesting program that is available in the terminal, it's called curl curl, we can access a URL on the web, and we can there specify exactly the type of access header that we want to see of a specific resource. And in the first case, we try this here with text HTML. And if I want to have it in the machine readable form, we simply change the accept header here then to application RDF XML. Okay, let's try this out. Okay, I have now opened a terminal window, and you see here I have already the first command, curl, and then I want to have the accept header text HTML, and I'm asking here for the dbpedia page resource earth. And we simply try this out. And what we are seeing here, so we can look at the code that comes back. So this clearly looks like HTML code. So what we get back here is the HTML rendering of exactly what we were looking for. Okay. However, now we want to do the other example. And there we want to access the same web page, but here we have the header application RDF plus XML. And now let's try this out. And you see here, this of course looks completely different. So we have here an RDF data that is here arranged or structured, serialized based on an XML rendering of that data. And we get only data back, which is machine readable, which is not an HTML page. Okay, you can play around with curl. So simply download curl if you don't have it. There are also online versions where you can try out exactly different kind of accept headers for this. And you can then learn how content negotiation via the hypertext transfer protocol really works. So by that, we have now the transport mechanism, the communication mechanism of the web of data. And this is exactly the same like in the traditional web. So we are also making use of, you know, the distinction here between human readable and machine readable data based here on a basic web technology, which is content negotiation. And by that, we already have implemented the first two linked data principles, which is number one, use URIs to name things, and number two, use HTTP URIs so that people can look up those names, and we have shown how to do that. And to provide now some useful information using exactly these kind of web standards, RDF, Sparkle, etc., this is then the next part. So everything, as I already told you, in the web of data, in linked data, is based on these RDF triples. So the resource description framework and these kind of triples are a standard serialization of information that is provided there, no matter what kind of, let's say, ontology description language or modeling language I have used then to describe exactly that kind of data. It's RDF in the end. And this, of course, how to do that, how to render RDF, and how this resource description framework works as a simple data model, you will learn in the next lecture.